Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. My name is Mark Handing. I am a sophomore at this university, and I am the founder of CSULA Young Americans for Freedom. To those of you who are interested in joining us, I welcome you with open arms. After this event, please come find me or any other of my members, and we will be more than happy to answer any questions that you have. The honor of introducing Rachel Campos-Duffy today is not mine. As a student who has 2 years left at CSULA, I realized soon that I will leave this university and move on to bigger and better things. The person introducing Ms. Duffy is one of my officers who I am incredibly proud of. He is an officer who I have mentored and I have seen tremendous growth from the recent months. He has transformed from being the shy kid in the back of the room who refused to say anything into now being one of the most dedicated and outspoken officers in the entire club. Everyone, please help me welcome the Secretary of CSULAF, Kevin Amador.
Rachel is an author, communications consultant, and television personality, specializing in political punditry, culture, and parenting. She is a Fox News contributor, and for 5 years was the national spokesperson for the Libra Initiative, a nonprofit that educates and advocates for the economic empowerment of Hispanics through limited government, entrepreneurship, and self-reliance. Rachel's television credits are large and diverse. She got her television start on MTV's iconic reality television show, The Real World. Currently, she is a contributor on Fox News and Fox Business, and a reoccurring guest on her daily hit show, Outnumbered, and their popular business show, Cashing In. For years, Rachel was a frequent guest on NBC's Today Show, and for 14 years, she was a reoccurring guest host on ABC's The View. Rachel writes for a wide range of publications, including the Huffington Post, National Review, International Journal Review, FoxNews.com, Fox News Latino, CNN.com, and Today'sMoms.com, among others. Her book, published in 2009 by Penguin, is called Stay Home, Stay Happy, 10 Secrets to Loving At-Home Motherhood. In 2008, co-hosted the series Speaking of Women's Health on the Lifetime Network with the legendary Florence Henderson. Rachel is a board member on the State of Wisconsin's Commission on the Future of Women and Children. She has a degree in economics from Arizona State University's Honors Program. She has a master's degree in international affairs with an emphasis on economic development in Latin America from the University of California, San Diego. Rachel is fluent in Spanish. Rachel lives in Wisconsin with her husband, Congressman Sean Duffy, and her 8 awesome kids.
For me as a parent, it's important for my kids to still appreciate how lucky we are to live in this country and the kind of sacrifices that their great-grandfather and their grandfather made so that they could have a better life. My name is Rachel Campos-Duffy. As a mother of 6, nothing is more important to me than my family. My grandparents came from Mexico, and my father was born in a small copper mining town in Arizona. They were very poor, but they were very resourceful. And so, even as a young kid, he was a shoeshine boy. He started his own piñata business when he was only 12 years old. So he's somebody who figured out at a very young age that what he couldn't do in Mexico, he could do in America, which was to transcend his poverty through hard work. When I was growing up, my dad was often in night school, earning his degree. And I think what he passed on to us, he didn't really tell us, he showed us. You know, Hispanics were not a monolithic group, but I think what we share, the most important thing we share, is a work ethic, is a drive, is a willingness to sacrifice for the next generation.
The reason why America is distinct from the rest of the world is because you can do whatever you want to do as long as you set your mind and establish your goals, you can do it.
This country gave my family the freedom and the opportunity to succeed. But I'm worried that government programs that are supposed to help Hispanic families are actually doing harm. I think kids are growing up in a time when this sense of entitlement and dependency on government is starting to take over. I know how hard my dad worked. I don't want my kids to lose that work ethic. And that's why I joined Libre, because it's an organization that mirrors the values I'm teaching my kids. Libra's mission is to be a voice for freedom, a voice for economic liberty, a voice for self-reliance, and the belief in America that if you work hard, you can make a better life for your family. We do this person to person, heart to heart, in the communities we want to serve, offering programs that empower people. We're on the ground, fighting for the freedom and opportunity that make the American dream possible. Join us at joinlibre.org.
Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Rachel Campos-Duffy.
Hello. Thank you for coming here, and I am so excited to be on this campus with you. I'm gonna make sure my phone is off. And hopefully I'll get this PowerPoint right. Where do I click on this part right here? Sorry about that, I just wanna make sure we're getting it all right.
So you can just hit forward to go forward.
Right here, okay.
And then if you wanna play the video, hover over here.
Hover over.
And there'll be a little play button, see right there?
You got it.
Okay.
Okay. So as you heard, my name is Rachel Campos-Duffy. I'm a conservative activist. I am a Fox News contributor. And for 4 years, I worked at the Libra Initiative, where we strived every day to economically empower Hispanics. As you heard, the video says I have 6 kids. I actually have 8. I've had 2 since that video was made. And I am married to Congressman Sean Duffy, who is a congressman in Wisconsin. My husband and I have a claim to fame. So we met on a reality television show called The Real World. Any of you guys heard of The Real World? But it was a long time ago. I was on the 3rd season. He was on the 5th season. We met on a reunion show. It was pretty fun. And we've been together. We'll be married 18 years. That's how long The Real World's been on. That's my family. And this here is a few years after we met, so that's our claim to fame. I think my most important title, though, is wife, it's mother. When you have 8 kids, I think it's safe to say that you're pretty optimistic about the future, and I have to say that I am. Today, Latina young women are enrolling in colleges and universities at higher rates. Can I put this up here where I can, let's see if I can move it. No, I can't move it. Okay, that's all right. It's in the little, Latina young women are enrolling at colleges and universities at higher rates than even non-Hispanic women. They're starting businesses at faster rates than other women in America. Latina women do not need Sheryl Sandberg or anyone else to tell us to lean in. We have been. As the influence of Hispanic women continues to grow, a Latina-centered version of American feminism is beginning to emerge, a feminism that is not tethered to the narrow agenda of abortion rights. Our definition of feminism celebrates the importance of men, family, children, cooperation, and hard work. Latina empowerment reflects our faith and our Hispanic cultural experiences and values, rather than the experiences and narrow definitions of success offered by old guard feminists and the white urban professional women who drive that agenda. It's a feminism that isn't angry or vulgar. It's unabashedly pro-life, pro-family, and it celebrates our fertility and unique contributions to the human family. We'll talk a little bit later in this discussion about Latina feminism. But first, I want to share with you a little bit more about who I am and where I come from. So as you saw in the video that we just had, my father's parents came to America from Mexico. And my dad was born in a very small copper mining town in Arizona called Sonora. He was the 11th of 15 children. Now, my dad's family was poorer than most in that town, which was saying something. It was a poor town. The Campos siblings had 1 green bike to share among all of them. And my dad occasionally recounts a pretty painful memory that he had from kindergarten, where a fellow classmate pulled down his pants to reveal the depth of his poverty, which was that they were so poor that they couldn't even afford underwear for him. And, you know, it's weird, right? You know, my dad's now in his 70s, and, if he tells you that story, you can still feel what that felt like. But out of that poverty and even the occasional humiliation came a work ethic and a resourcefulness that has been his greatest asset. Now, in addition to being a shoeshine boy, my dad and his brothers were young entrepreneurs. They sold cactus leaves door to door. They would go into the desert mountains that surrounded their town in Sonora. They'd gather the cactus leaves, they'd peel, they'd clean, they'd dice them, and then they'd sell them to the neighbors to earn some extra money. Later on, he became an apprentice to a young man who was a piñata maker. And then at the tender age of 12, with the help of his mother, who would make the glue on the stove and helped him put his finished products in the local market, my dad became, he started his own business. He started his own little piñata business at 12. At the age of 18, he joined the U.S. Air Force after high school, and he married my mom and started a family. Even as a soldier in the Air Force, my dad was never above taking on extra work after hours. So after a long day of working on the base, he'd wash dishes at night at a Chinese restaurant. My mother, who still at that point wasn't fluent in English, she would go to a local beauty salon and sweep floors. My parents did everything they could to get their little family ahead. Now, it didn't take long for my parents to figure out that education was the fastest route to the middle class that they so wanted their children to be a part of. And so, as you heard in that video, when I was growing up, my dad was often at night school earning his degree. My mother taught herself English, which I will tell you, English is the language of opportunity if you live in America, and everyone should learn it. She got her GED in night school. And when I was a sophomore, I went to Arizona State University. I woke up one day to find out that my mother, who was now in her 40s, late 40s, had registered as a freshman at Arizona State University with me, which at that time I was not very pleased about. but she wanted to complete her dream of having a college education. So my parents taught us by example about education, about opportunity, and the American dream. Now, the most important thing that my parents taught us, however, was that we were not victims. They always maintained their optimism. They always maintained their dignity. Now today, that shoeshine boy is retired very comfortably in sunny Arizona with my mother. His four grown children have all received postgraduate degrees. So I have two brothers who have law degrees. My sister and I both went on to earn our masters. And his kids and his 16 now grandkids, I take up most of the grandkids' number, so it's a big number, but it's mostly mine. They live lives that surpass even my father's wildest dreams as a child. My family, like so many of your families, is the embodiment of the American dream. And for that, I will be eternally grateful to this awesome country. Now, today, I wonder sometimes if my dad's American dream is in peril. As a mom, I want my kids to have the same work ethic and self-reliance that propelled my family into the middle class. Increasingly, though, our culture is turning to entitlements and depending more and more on government instead of the self-initiative and hard work that has always been the source of America and Hispanic communities' success. In addition, under Barack Obama, our government began regulating and taxing in ways that hurt Hispanics. America's most entrepreneurial demographic, I don't know if you guys know this, but Hispanics start businesses at 3 times the rate of the average American. So when you're talking about regulating businesses, when you're talking about taxes, you're hurting Hispanics. Under Barack Obama, regulations exploded at an unprecedented pace, and small businesses were forced to scale back growth or shutter their businesses altogether. Under the Obama administration, 2 million more Hispanics fell into poverty. Income inequality, something that Barack Obama ran on, worsened. And Obamacare regulations turned once full-time jobs into part-time jobs that could not support families. Now, despite what the media says, jobs and the economy are the two top issues that Hispanics care about. It's not immigration, though that's important to us, but jobs and the economy are number one and number two. As we look to solutions that expand opportunity and access to the American dream, I say to you and I ask you when you talk to your friends, let's stop talking about political parties. Let's talk about ideas. Not ideology, but ideas. Things that work. The truth is, there are good ideas on both sides of the aisle. One of the most important policy ideas that conservatives espouse, that liberals really ought to get on board with, is parental choice in education. Nothing gets my Latina blood boiling faster than the hypocrisy of politicians who shut down school voucher programs for the poor and for minorities while they send their own children to elite private schools. Both the Clintons and the Obamas sent their own daughters to private school while fighting against Hispanic and Black parents who wanted the same thing for their children. It is fundamentally unfair and un-American for your zip code to determine the quality of your education. Access to a good education is a civil right, not a privilege reserved for the wealthy and the well-connected. Competition works in education. If I ask my 9-year-old son to run from the front of the house to the mailbox, will he run faster if he runs alone or if he runs with his sister? Now, any parent can tell you the answer to that. With his sister, of course. Competition makes us run faster. It forces businesses and institutions to innovate and perform better. Competition works. It's just common sense. And like so many universities, CSULA students debate the merits of economic justice and the benefits of socialism versus entrepreneurial capitalism. I believe that that discussion is incomplete without an understanding and an appreciation for why Hispanics risk everything to come to America. CSULA has an incredibly diverse student body. Many of you and your families came here from Latin America. Hispanics come to America to work. They come for the opportunity that only America's free market economy offers because nothing has lifted more people out of poverty than entrepreneurial capitalism. Humans naturally seek freedom, including economic freedom. They leave places like El Salvador and Mexico where connections to government and power are rewarded instead of ingenuity and hard work. Places where you can't count on the rules or where corruption and crime runs rampant. Now, I know that Beyonce and Jay-Z think Cuba's a pretty hip vacation spot, but for millions of Cubans, it is a place of unspeakable poverty and repression. The dysfunctional, centralized economies and political systems of Cuba, Venezuela, Bolivia, they leave families desperate for freedom and opportunity. Socialist governments like that of Nicolas Maduro in Venezuela, they imprison their political rivals. There's one right now, the most handsome, Leopoldo, 42 years old, sitting in prison. Why? Because he dared to run against Maduro. In communist Cuba, dissidents are executed. They disappear. They languish in gulags, Castro's gulags for decades. Communism and socialism are what drives a mother to put her baby on a rickety raft in shark-infested waters in hopes that she will land in America. Hispanics come to America risking everything to work hard and to create their own destiny. And once we are here, we are not interested in scraps off the government table to make us comfortable in our poverty. We want policies that allow us to lift our families out of poverty and into the ranks of the middle class and beyond. Plain and simple, Hispanics care about small businesses. They care about taxes. They care about regulations. They want economic liberty, even if some of us don't even know what that term means. Now, here's what I know from years of working and speaking with Hispanics across this country. Hispanics do not reject the principles of free market, limited government, individual liberty, personal responsibility, parental choice in education. There is simply an absence of those voices promoting these ideas, explaining these ideas in our communities. When Hispanics hear these ideas, they say to us, "Why hasn't anyone told me this before?" I want you to watch this video. This is a very good friend of mine. In fact, he was my boss for a long time. This is the story of Daniel Garza, and I think it tells the story of the American dream, of why people leave Latin America, and what an amazing opportunity it is to live in America and prosper. So let's look at this story. Here we go. Are we here? No, we're number five. Got it, thanks.
My name is Daniel Garza, and my American experience started off here. I grew up picking crops with my family. My parents were immigrants from Mexico with nothing but a fourth grade education. We were so poor. My siblings and I would often miss school to work in the fields. Our home was the size of a tool shed. It had no running water. And what we would do is warm buckets of water on the stove so that when my parents returned from work in the fields, they would bathe with small cups. My father never took welfare because he didn't want to depend on anyone or lose his dignity. He is a proud and noble man.
He can make it with just three things. It's God, good credit, and freedom, liberty to work. And that's what the United States is.
You know, I didn't know it at the time, but my father began saving money and buying and selling small properties. He bought a motel with the profit he made. My family and I spent long hours fixing up that motel while still working the fields. My father continued to buy and sell property, and one day he and my mother retired with enough money to live comfortably for the rest of their lives.
If I don't come to the United States, I don't think I have the life that we got right now, living so good, you know.
My parents' American dream had become a reality. My family and I have succeeded by following the path to freedom, but that path is on the verge of vanishing. What we're starting to see here in America now is a growth in the size and the scope of government that is now starting to look like the governments that we left behind. I'm just torn apart when I see folks who are caught in this dependency that government offers. And not only that, they've condemned their children to a life of mediocrity and subsistence. That this is not the American dream. This is an American nightmare. The Libre Initiative is reaching the Hispanic community before they are lost forever. We know advancing economic freedom is the best way to improve human well-being, especially those at the bottom. And that's our message to the world. You know, one day I was speaking before a group of 150 evangelical Hispanic ministers in South Texas, and a man stood up. He had tears in his eyes and said, "You know, I've never heard these things before. Why has nobody told us?" Most Hispanics have never even heard about economic freedom, but they know it. Cuba, Venezuela, Mexico. Hispanics leave countries that have been ruined by tyranny to come to America, the land of the free. They don't just believe in the cause, they've lived it. It is a privilege to live in the United States because this is a nation where you dictate your destiny. No other nation has fulfilled more dreams and more aspirations than this country. And to have been born here, I'm just grateful to God for that.
Learn how you can get involved at joinlibre.org.
It's a powerful story. It's a true story. It's a story that's repeated over and over again in America. And it's why so many people clamor to come here. Conservative free market ideas are not just popular with hardworking immigrants seeking upward mobility like Daniel. Our ideas are also attractive to aspirational young people. Now, you may not believe that if you look at popular culture. I mean, there was a lot of Bernie fans out there last summer. There are a lot of college students pointing, you know, they're sporting Che Guevara shirts. They're missing their Bernie Sanders rallies from last summer. But Reason Magazine, this is very interesting, Reason Magazine reported that millennials who do not go to college have a more favorable view of capitalism. That's interesting, isn't that? But here's another interesting fact. It turns out that a lot of young people don't even know what socialism means, because when you switch out, they say they took that poll, they took a poll of kids who like, you know, socialism. So when you switch out the word socialism for its definition, an economy managed by the government, it turns out that the same that the poll with the same group of millennials preferred free markets 64-32. So when you ask them about if they like socialism, they like, you know, they poll that they like socialism. When you switch out the word socialism, say, do you like an economy managed by the government? They don't like that. Now, I bet if we polled millennials and asked them if the government should take over the internet or Apple or Uber or Facebook or further regulate their microbreweries or their Korean Mexican fusion taco trucks, I bet all of these young people would say, heck no. Now, it's cool for celebrities like Matt Damon and Kanye West to rail against the man and capitalism, the very system, by the way, that made them ridiculously wealthy. There's no doubt that in popular culture, the voices in defense of liberty and free market are scarce. But I want you to take a look at this video and tell me that these celebrities are not closet conservatives or perhaps libertarians. Let's take a look at this one.
Think about the last 5 years. Enter our protagonist. Enter the most powerful force for change on the continent. Enter the strongest, loudest, clearest voice for progress. Enter commerce. Entrepreneurial capitalism takes more people out of poverty than aid, of course, we know that.
I believe that opportunity looks a lot like hard work. When I was 13, I had my first job with my dad carrying shingles up to the roof. And then I got a job washing dishes at a restaurant. And then I got a job in a grocery store deli. And then I got a job in a factory sweeping Cheerio dust off the ground. And I've never had a job in my life that I was better than. And every job I had was a stepping stone to my next job. And I never quit my job until I had my next job. And so opportunities look a lot like work.
To all my little homeboys and homegirls back in the city, I came up in that same county building. Food stamps, welfare, Section 8. Check it out. You looking at me on TV right now, this is living proof that you can do anything you put your mind to, you feel me? Real talk. They call us the minority, you know, the black and brown, blacks, Latinos, but for sure, if you keep love, God, respect, and hard work in your heart, you can do anything you want in life, all right?
I mean, it's all about hard work, I think. For me, that's what it was about. I went and I took dance classes and I offered my help to work at the desk so I could take all the free dance classes that I wanted. Because that's what I wanted to do. I think eventually hard work, dedication, and a willingness to learn everything without any ego is what is really the recipe for success. And you have to really know who you are. You really have to remember where you started, who you are, and nobody can change that.
Thank you.
These ideas are the recipe for how to achieve success and the American dream, and how in America, with faith, liberty to work and prosper, respect for the Constitution, for rule of law, people can lift themselves out of poverty with dignity using their God-given talent, creativity, and always with hard work. Now, at this point, I want to transition a little over to talk about feminism and Latino women and how we are transforming, I think, in many ways, or redefining what that means. Over the last couple of months, we've seen huge feminist protest marches. The first one drew, frankly, bigger crowds than a presidential inauguration. I know this to be true because I attended the inauguration, and the next day, I went and visited the march. There were at least 500,000 people at the Women's March. The organizers and the women marchers deserve a lot of credit, I think, for that extraordinary turnout. It is especially impressive that they were able to turn this kind of crowd out after what I think was a pretty scathing and depressing defeat for Democrats in November. But as a conservative observer, the size of the crowd isn't really what caught the most attention to me. I was really taken aback by the vulgarity on display at that march. Now, maybe that's a sign of my age, but it was very off-putting to me. We were in DC, we were obviously with our kids, and it was pretty shocking to my kids, too. I don't think our power as women comes from being as crass and vulgar as the lowest common denominator of the opposite sex. It's just not the way I view things. Ashley Judd's remarks, if you go back and listen to them on YouTube, were especially foul. Our power as women comes from using our gender to elevate the debate. Whatever happened to when they go low, we go high? That kind of went out the window with that march, if you ask me. If Trump's vulgarity offends, and it should at times, it definitely should, we lose our moral high ground when we as a gender go there too. But what caught my attention happened actually days before the march, when a pro-life feminist group called the New Wave Feminists, who were frankly very opposed to Donald Trump, had their partnership status with the march revoked. This tweet here pretty much sums the debate. We need to stop the myth that feminism is simply anything a woman does. Feminism is a movement for justice. Abortion access is central. And then the response, so a woman can't be a feminist if she's pro-life? That excludes a lot of women in developing countries, women of different faiths. It's an interesting debate. American feminism has evolved to become almost exclusively about abortion rights. Now, as a conservative woman, that's a pretty perplexing thing. Feminism, like so many other progressive movements, was supposed to be about expanding rights to more and more people, especially the most vulnerable among us. Surely a helpless unborn child fits that definition. Moreover, the movement purports to protect women from violence and exploitation. What can be more violent than abortion, or exploitative than taking money from a woman who feels desperate and trapped while pitting her against her own child? Women, I say to you, deserve better. Now, as a culture, we must do better at providing non-violent alternatives and solutions for women facing difficult pregnancies. But putting the issue of abortion aside, the march in Washington in the eyes of conservatives and many independents and even apolitical women also exposed the deep intolerance liberals purport to be against. If you recall, Madonna said that she dreamed of blowing up the White House. I have pro-life women friends who went to the march and were spat on. The hypocrisy of liberal mantras for more tolerance or to coexist and to, you know, love Trump's hate, I think was best captured by a woman. I don't know if you saw this video, but there was a woman, you can look it up on YouTube, it actually went viral. A woman who on the way home from the march, she refused to sit, just to sit on a plane next to a Trump supporter. She actually asked the flight attendant, it was all captured on video, asked the flight attendant to be moved because she couldn't even sit on a plane next to somebody who had a different point of view than her. So much for liberal tolerance. So who are conservative women? What do we know about them? Do they deserve to be called feminists too? Well, it turns out there's been some recent research on women that shed some light on this subject. Now, since 1972, the University of Chicago has been conducting a general social survey, and one of the things that this survey measures is happiness. The survey concludes that conservative women are the happiest. If there's any conservative women out there, we'd be happy to know that. About 40% say they are very happy. That makes them slightly happier than conservative men and significantly happier than liberal women. The unhappiest group of all, liberal men. Only about 1/5 of liberal men consider themselves to be happy. So the question is, why are conservative women so much more blissful? It turns out that there are three things that contribute most to human happiness, and they are family, community, including faith community, and work. And I would suggest to you that these are things that come very naturally to conservative lifestyles, and specifically to conservative women. Now, interestingly, there's another happiness study that came out not too long ago that said that women who say that they have turned down a promotion or made some other work sacrifice for the sake of their families report higher levels of happiness. That's very counterintuitive to what the feminist movement says. This may be another clue about why conservative women are happier. Conservative women simply do not feel compelled to follow a rigid feminist script. So Sheryl Sandberg famously told, I forgot to show this one. Let me just move ahead on that. We kind of skipped over that. That was the lady on the plane. Sheryl Sandberg famously told women during a commencement speech to put your foot on the gas pedal and keep it there. Now, my advice to young women is exactly the opposite. Pursue your dreams, but do not be afraid to slow down or jump off the professional train when your heart calls you to tend to things that last. Love, marriage, babies, happy kids. You can always jump back on the train. It is, after all, your journey. You don't have to choose between June Cleaver or Barbara Walters. There is miles of space in between these two models. Now, when I was pregnant with baby number one, I was an at-home mom by default. I thought I was in between jobs. Now, with time, my decision to be home with my kids became a very conscious one that I felt was right for me and for my husband and for my family. It was not a choice that I felt was very valued by the feminist movement. I recall when a Democrat conservative candidate, you may recall it's when Mitt Romney was running, his wife Ann Romney, there was a Democrat pundit who said that, quote, Ann Romney, who by the way had five boys, never worked a day in her life, end quote. Conservative women were in an uproar about that. But I think that that comment goes to the heart of how a lot of at-home moms feel they are treated and undervalued by feminists for making a choice to be home with their kids. Now, the most surprising thing to me was that the more kids I had, the more I found I was able to put on my plate. Having kids taught me to prioritize, to delegate, to accept life's imperfections more gracefully. I also learned the all-important skill of jumping off the train, taking breaks in my career and passion pursuits to tend to the things that last, while ignoring, and this is the hard part, ignoring other people's judgments about it. It's scary. You jump off the train and you wonder if you can get back on. You wonder if you'll ever still be relevant in the public world. But every single time I had a child, I came back stronger. I lived my life and cared for my family as the seasons of my life demanded. I ignored the trends and voices telling me that what I was doing at home with my kids and my family wasn't important, or that it would take me permanently out of a professional game. I stubbornly refused to listen, and I remained true to my heart, true to my values, and true to all those things that I say last. Now, in time, I came to realize that there are people, companies, organizations that could benefit from my experiences. Network editors, political consultants, they all want to know how millions of hardworking moms like me think. And so I wrote a blog. And then one day I decided I was gonna write a book. As an at-home mom, when I was home, my husband decided he wanted to run for Congress. So I helped him do that, and he won. I became my husband's speechwriter. I used my political experience to become a political pundit, a media spokesperson, a consultant, and now I'm a Fox News contributor. It didn't happen overnight. It's been 20 years in the making. I started out on a little-known blog. I eventually got published. I was eventually published on websites, established websites after my little blog. I did Skype interviews out of my living room, bribing my kids to stay quiet for 3 minutes while I'm on CNN. Eventually, those small jobs led to on-air live in-studio interviews and then to regular guest spots. There are times I had to say no because a child was sick or because I was too pregnant to travel. Other times I was so tired and homesick, I wished that I had said no. Finding the right balance in life is experimental. It's imperfect. It requires a lot of recalibration, but we learn and we grow. Today, I work and write from home. As a Fox News contributor, I do television hits via satellite at a studio that's about 10 minutes from my home. I travel to New York once a month where I do shows in studio. I have to tell you, my life and professional work today are more interesting than I would have ever imagined when I first held my first child in my arms. At that time, I was madly in love with that baby, but I was terrified about how she or future siblings would alter my life. Motherhood, if you have not experienced it in this room, and a lot of you are so young, it is a very beautifully life-changing experience. What I've learned is that instead of fighting its constraints, that I just had to surrender to them, realize that it's making me more patient, more wise, better prepared to pursue my dreams. Let those decisions in life shape the contours of your journey into a life well-lived and blessed by the things that last. My final piece of advice to any of the women here today is definitely not Gloria Steinem approved. And that is to understand, and this goes for the men here too, the most important decision you will ever make as an adult is who you marry. And so my advice to the women in this room, again, if Gloria Steinem were here, she'd probably tackle me. But my advice is do not let a good man, a kind man, a supportive man, a man you are desperately in love with, slip away. I put my career on hold and moved to a little town in Wisconsin. I was living here in LA, getting my start in life. I was on The View. I was auditioning on The View. I put my career on hold to move to a little town in Wisconsin with 2,000 people to be with the man that I loved. And at that time, I knew Barbara Walters, and she thought I was absolutely crazy. She even interviewed me many years later on the show, and she asked me why I gave up a fledgling and promising career in broadcasting to move to rural Wisconsin. Why? Because I was following my heart. I was being true to myself and not some feminist script that defined empowerment for me. Next month, I will celebrate 18 years of marriage. With eight kids. Thank you. My husband is my soulmate, who has supported me in every single dream I've ever had, and that, in my view, is priceless. Conservative women, Latina women like me, are proudly redefining feminism in a way that actually gives women more freedom to chart their course and define happiness and success on their own terms, not Gloria Steinem's, not Sheryl Sandberg's. Conservative feminism expands the array of acceptable choices for women. It doesn't shame women for pursuing love, marriage, or at-home parenting. It doesn't disparage men. It appreciates their unique and irreplaceable contributions to the world, and frankly, to our security. It accepts the complementarity of the sexes. It respects the dignity of women and their children. Modern feminism would benefit from the inclusion of conservative women and pro-life Latino women in their movement. So with that, I am ready to take any questions if anybody has any on the first part of the talk or the last.
So now we'll take any questions. If you have it, please line up in this line right here located on your left.
Hi, Rachel. Thank you for coming out. Great speech.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
I'm just curious. You talked about schools and public schools and how politicians send their children to elite private schools. And I was wondering, if you had an opportunity to impact public schooling, how would you make it better?
So first of all, I'm for all choices. So I have 8 kids. One of my kids actually goes to public school. It's just a better school for him. And I just think that parents are the best people to decide which school is best for that child. So I want to expand choices. I don't want to disparage public schools. In the case of my kid's public school, I think it's a great school for him. How would I improve public education? I think that by simply adding more choices, that public schools, this is what we talked about earlier, competition, that when there are more choices of where a parent can send their school, that school, the schools in that area have to step it up to compete. And so I think that expanding choices will improve public schools. And I believe that on average we spend about $13,000, I think, on average per kid. I think that money should follow the kid. I think that money belongs to the kid, and that child's parents are better equipped to make the choice of where that child should go. And I think that at times they're going to pick public schools, because frankly there's a lot of really great public schools out there. But I think that right now we have places where it's just an injustice that people would be trapped in schools that aren't functioning, and people just telling them, hey, just deal with it. I think parents have to have the choice.
Thank you.
You got it. Thank you. Okay. Hi.
Hi, yo soy un conservador latino, y cuando yo le digo a otros latinos que yo soy un conservador, la primera cosa que me dicen es que yo soy un traidor. Mm-hmm. ¿Y cómo respondes a esas personas que dicen que yo soy un traidor?
Es una pregunta muy buena. I've been called La Malinche. So, you know what? First of all, those of you who are in the YAF program in this school, kudos to you. It takes a lot of courage to be who you are, believe what you believe, stand up for what you believe, and not be intimidated. Again, the whole purpose of me coming here today is to tell you that these ideas are Hispanic ideas in so many ways. I mean, just look at the figure I gave you on entrepreneurship. We start businesses at 3 times the rate of the average American. We are the most entrepreneurial demographic in this country. We need to stop thinking in parties, and we need to think about ideas. If we are entrepreneurial, we need to go and support whatever policies are helping us to bring those entrepreneurial ideas, our work ethic, to fruition so we can advance ourselves and our families. So to those who say we're traitors, I say you're closed-minded, that you're intolerant, that you're not looking at ideas, that you're looking at political parties, that you're stuck in ideology. We need to move beyond that. I really want to encourage you guys to continue to educate yourselves, because oftentimes at university settings, we're given one line of what we should believe, and it's really incumbent on us to explore what the other options are. I don't believe that any ideas are racially defined. I'm a Hispanic. I love my culture. But I'm an American first, and I'm an American first. And you know, I'll tell you straight up. My husband's a congressman. I went to dinner once with a Mexican dignitary who said, you know what, I could help you get, you know, dual citizenship with Mexico because your grandfather. And I was very polite. I'm very diplomatic. But when I left, my husband said, what are you going to do? And I said, of course not. I'm an American. I came here. You know, my family came here. I'm an American. And I love free markets. I love, as long as it's fair. And I love entrepreneurial capitalism because I've seen how it's worked and lifted people out of poverty. And I don't think these ideas should be racialized. We should look at ideas. There are good ideas on both sides of the aisle. And we should look at it not through a racial prism, that somehow we're betraying our race or our culture by having expanded views. So again, congratulations to all of you for your courage. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, my name is Miriam Antonio. I have a question.
Say your name again.
Miriam Antonio.
Okay, yeah, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. So you emphasize a lot on how women shouldn't be afraid to jump off the train, you know, and stay at home. Wouldn't you say that should also apply? Why is it that just women should stay at home? And what about men? You don't think they have kind of like a part in taking care of the kids? Because we always see, you know, it's mostly the women who stay at home and take care of the kids. And people, when they think about raising kids, it's always just the women who do it. But why not emphasize on also men should take responsibility in?
Absolutely, men should take responsibility for the children. In my home, the care of kids is very egalitarian when we're both home. But when I decided that I wanted to be an at-home parent, that's the choice I made. I wanted to, and I probably there's some biological pull to that. I mean, I was a nursing mom. As much as my husband loves our kids, he can't nurse. And so that didn't work out. So for me, that's a choice that I wanted to make. My husband, in his case, he took time off after we had the baby to help, but he was ready to get back to work and support his family. So look, it doesn't always work out that way. Every family is different. Some women make more money than their husbands, and it makes more sense for them to go out and work and the husband to stay home. What I am talking about is not that people should be defined by their gender. What I am talking about is women having the options to make the choices that are right for their families without being disparaged by a movement, in this case feminism, that thinks that that's not a worthy choice. I mean, my husband's a congressman. When I was home, I don't think what he was doing was any more important than what I was doing. And so I think that what we need to do is start valuing all kinds of work. There's dignity in all work, whether you're working at a fast food restaurant, whether you're passing laws at the California State House, or whether you're an at-home mother. All these things are valuable and important to our society. So I hope you don't think that I'm saying all women should stay home. What I am saying is that we live in a very interesting age where I think before we didn't have choices between going to work and staying home. We were given one choice. And then suddenly the 70s came around and the 80s and the 90s, and people who wanted to stay home were often looked at as they were betraying the movement. How dare you have a master's degree and not, you know, work in a law firm or a law degree and work in a law firm or have a master's and pursue a full-time work outside the home. I just really think women should have a full range of options and not be disparaged for making those choices. Thank you. Hi.
Hello, Rachel. Sorry about my voice.
What's your name?
Pablo.
Pablo, nice to meet you, Pablo.
Nice to meet you too. I have a question. Why do you believe that as time goes on, Americans feel more and more polarized with one another? I mean, when we talk about America, we're not just talking about white, we're talking about white, red, and blue. We're talking about all people from different ages, from different places. I mean, my father's from Mexico, but I feel as if though that we've just become, we've lost what it means to be an American.
Yes.
And why do you believe this is happening? Why do you believe all this disparity?
It's such a great question. I think there's two things that are happening. So when my father, first generation born here in the United States, I believe that the schools he went to, the organizations that were in his town, that all those things worked to assimilate us so that we weren't, you know, now you hear the word a lot, multiculturalism. And a word like assimilation kind of has a negative term these days. But back in when I was growing up, and especially when my father was growing up, the melting pot was considered a really wonderful thing. It's what made us all American. And I think lately we've been focusing a lot on what makes us different. I think there are institutional and cultural things that are driving that, political things that are driving that. You know, a lot of politicians, they get their power by dividing us, by race, by color, by our sexual orientation. And so there's a lot of forces out there that are dividing us in that way and not uniting us. The other thing is, I think religion and civic organizations are on decline. And so, you know, you might not share the same political, you and I might not share the same political view, but if we go to the same church, there's something bigger than politics that unites us, right? Or if we're all part of the same, you know, Boy Scout, our kids all go to the same Boy Scouts, or we're all part of the Rotary Club, those things are in decline. And so there are less civic organizations that are helping us look beyond the, you know, politics is by nature, you know, polarizing, right? I mean, these are two very different ideas. I mean, I know when my husband was in Congress, a lot of people would complain all the time, you know, why can't the Republicans and, you know, Barack Obama and the Democrats and the Republicans, why can't they all come together? Well, these are very different ideas. I mean, you see this, what the discussion we had today, socialism and big government versus freedom and liberty and free enterprise. These are very different ideas of how, so it's natural that politics and ideas could draw us apart, but we need more things that draw us together. And so I think the more we're secularized, we're also seeing another thing happening, which we're starting to grapple with a little bit more, which is that people who are rich increasingly live in rich neighborhoods away from people who aren't like them, and they become more homogenized. I live in a little town in central Wisconsin, and you know, you'll see a really nice house, and like, not like down the street is a not so nice house. I mean, all these people intersect all the time. And that's how small town America has always been, but it's becoming a little bit more like urban and suburban America, where we're starting to see, even in rural America, some of those divisions come. But, you know, two generations ago, it was very common for rich, poor, middle class to all kind of live together, go to the same schools. It's still happening in rural America. In urban America, in suburban America, that's not happening. And so that's also drawing us apart. There's a lot of social forces out there. I don't know how to shift that and change that. The only thing I think we can do is stop seeing ourselves as, you know, other than American. I mean, the more we see ourselves as American, the more we encourage people who come to our country to learn a language that unifies us, to learn civics, to go through the process, the more we put in American history. I mean, I never felt like studying Washington or Jefferson was white history. I thought it was American history. I've always felt I was very American. So I think all of these things, we need to really rethink what we're doing. And a lot of the division is frankly happening at the university level. And I think it's really incumbent on those of you who are conservative in this room or even apolitical to demand of your colleges and universities to offer a curriculum that is not so divisive.
Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Victor. I have a question in two parts. You say that the free market is the answer for education.
Mm-hmm.
Do you really?
It's part of the answer.
Do you really think that free market could fix our education problem?
And I don't think it'll fix it, but it can improve it. Continue.
Given that there's been recent scandals with the closing of ITT Tech, the DeVron, and many issues at the University of Phoenix, and the recent settlement of $25 million by the Trump University. So do you really think the free market could fix school systems?
Well, I hardly think that I'm here defending Trump University, but I will say this. There are scandals in public schools as well. There'll be scandals in charter schools and in private institutions. I don't think, you know, that's part of human nature, that there will be people who are dishonest. What I'm saying is not that the free market will resolve it, but part of the problem is that when you have no competition and when you have no incentive to improve or fix things that aren't working, they won't get fixed. They won't change. We need to, when you have something that's very centralized, by definition, it becomes less innovative. And you can see that whether it's healthcare, whether it's education, we need to decentralize, allow people to find solutions that work for their communities, and frankly, introduce competition into education. I just simply disagree with you. And I don't think a few examples of Trump University, which has absolutely nothing to do with the school choice debate, in any way undermines my argument. But thank you for the question.
Hello.
Yes.
Sorry. Hello, Rachel. My name is Joseph, and
hi, Joseph.
I mean, you gave like a great speech when you considered the United States the land of opportunity on how you could run your own business mm-hmm. and all that. But I've been in several debates with my friends saying that we actually need regulations, especially by the EPA, because let's say in the food industry, you could get a disease if like several businesses are not regulated. How would you sure. respond to that?
I don't believe in no regulation. I believe in smart regulation. And I think what ends up happening a lot of times is that the regulations get out of control because there's bureaucrats who are, their whole job is to create regulations. And so I think what we need to have is smart regulations and an understanding of how regulations help and then how they hurt. I know like in Wisconsin, the EPA wants to monitor puddles in dairy farms. That's simply, you want to put small farms out of business, start regulating puddles on their farms. So I think we have to be smart about it. You're right. There are, you can look at the Flint, Michigan case, no question. Conservatives are not against clean water. In fact, conservatives love the outdoors. They're outdoorsmen, they're hunters, they're fishers. They have an appreciation for that. But I think that there's a way to find a balance between clean air, clean water, and access to lands, for example. So I think smart regulation is the way to go. All regulations are not good. There are some dumb ones out there, and we should probably vet them out and get rid of them. You got it.
Hello. I have a question on,
sure.
Do you think this situation that's happening in the schools where they're trying to restrict free speech has any comparison to like during World War II that was going on in Germany, that was going on in a lot of educational places that were stifling open minds?
It's a very good question. I don't know if it's gotten to the level that you're describing in that historical situation, but I do think that it's a problem. I mean, if free speech can't exist on a college campus, where can we? And what ends up happening, and what I think is happening even as I see my own kids, we start to self-censor ourselves. I mean, that was really how they controlled thoughts and people in the era that you're talking about. If you censor speech so much so that if you say something, you're going to be accused of being a racist or a sexist or whatever it is, eventually, it's not just that you'll stop saying those things because you don't want to be accused of that. You'll stop thinking those things. And I think then we start to get into a dangerous zone because there's a lot of people, people can debate all kinds of issues. You can even take a contentious issue like the border. There are plenty of Hispanics who think we should secure our border. Are they racist too? I think that we can have a debate about things without racializing everything and without assuming the worst in each other. And so I think that if we can't get a grip on this at the university level, we're gonna be in trouble because the last thing we want is to graduate really smart people like we have right here who can't handle a different idea. You start to get to the lady like we said on the plane where, you can't even sit next to someone who doesn't share your point of view. I don't want to live in a country with just Republicans, frankly. I like Democrats. I like a lot of things they do. Our local, we have a farmer's market in our town. Frankly, I don't think it would run if it wasn't for liberals. They make our town better. And so I think that we need to be diverse. And we talk a lot in universities about diversity, but it's always about diversity of sex and gender. What about diversity of ideas? That's the most important thing that a university can strive towards, the diversity of ideas. Thank you for that question.
Hi, Mrs. Campos.
Hi.
I'm Kevin.
Nice to meet you.
Lovely dress, by the way.
Thank you.
Okay, so my question is about conservative values.
Sure.
So you consider yourself a conservative, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so.
I do.
Okay, so my question is about preserving those conservative values, specifically in 2017, with mm-hmm. just how, with technological growth and economic growth. So
sure.
my question specifically is, how can you make a rapid and drastic change in technology and the economy of society without causing rapid changes in all other aspects of society as well, which in turn would end those traditional values of conservatism.
So am I correct that you're saying that rapid changes in technology, what's the second part?
And economic growth.
So and economic growth.
Yeah, I can give you an example.
But the last part of it was?
Oh, okay.
Without
so,
what?
So without causing rapid changes in all other aspects of society as well.
Well, sure. You know, technological changes will change society. We see there's migration. There's all kinds of things. I think, again, it kind of goes back to some of these civic organizations. It can kind of go back to what we talked about, a decline in religious organizations. Finding things that unite us will allow us to grow through these changes without massive disruption on the social family level. But look, people are going to have to adjust to economic changes. So, you know, as the world becomes more technological, our schools will have to adapt to that and teach people different things. And I think, you know, as a country, we have to acknowledge that. I mean, we see in manufacturing that things are changing. And as manufacturing jobs decrease, towns lose those factories and people move, and there's all kinds of social disruptions. So I think, how does that affect conservative values? I mean, our values are about advancing. I mean, I know the liberals call themselves progressives. It's a great term. We're also for progress. Conservatism means conserving certain values, but it doesn't mean that we're against seeing economic advancements. Okay, I'm so sorry. Maybe we can talk after. I'd love to hear what you have to say.
This is our last question.
Okay.
Well, as an American of Mexican descent, growing up, I used to be pretty liberal, and
okay.
I used to have trouble identifying where I am. Am I Mexican? Am I American? And upon doing so much research, I even took a Chicano studies course right now. And one thing I noticed is that Americans of Mexican descent have trouble trying to find out their identity. Well, after, you know, I did a transition from liberal to conservative,
Can I ask you, when did that happen? Did that happen in college?
It happened before college, actually.
Okay.
I'm so grateful that it did.
And did it happen? I'm just so curious. Did it happen just because you were reading, or did you meet somebody, or?
One of my biggest heroes is Jaime Escalante. Have you heard of him?
No.
He taught at a high school.
Yes, I know. He taught
a bunch of illiterate kids AP
yes.
calculus.
Yep.
And
the movie was made about it, right?
Yeah. And he was one of my idols. Mm-hmm. But then I realized this guy, with the principles that he teaches other Mexicans, so Mexican Americans or Americans, is hard work. You walk into the future with hard work. I look at the people that most people of Hispanic descent look up to. They have Che Guevara shirts or Fidel Castro shirts. But why do people love Che Guevara and not Jaime Escalante? Like those kinds of people.
Sure. I just want to hear more about your story. I don't know. I think it goes back to the university. I think that there, and I think it goes back to, you know, the glamorization of socialism and frankly a system of government and economy that has been proven over and over again not to work. It's very utopian. It sounds really nice. It doesn't work in practice. So I don't know, because I look at our values, and that's why I wanted to come here and speak with you guys today, because I look at who we are as Latinos, and I feel the same way you do. I think we're about hard work. I think we come here to this country to work. I think we're about family. I think we're about entrepreneurship. I think we're about passing something onto our children, that's a value, a better life, and when I look at all those things, my father was a Democrat. He was, you know, it's kind of like you're born, you're Mexican, you're a Democrat, and he was. And Ronald Reagan was the first time that he ever voted for a Republican, and it was really because he was in the military, and he liked that Ronald Reagan was going to sort of revitalize the military. But after he cast that first vote for a Republican, he started to read a little bit more and study a little bit more. Now, what is it that the Democrats stand for? And what is it that the Republicans stand for? And he started to realize that when he could just take the party labels out of the way, and he just looked at the ideas, and he just looked at the values, it was very clear to him, from abortion to hard work to free markets to entrepreneurship to taxes and regulations. I mean, the list went on, and choice in education, all of them, on and on and on. He's like, darn it, I guess I'm a Republican. And then, you know, we were all born and we were all raised Republicans. And I'm very grateful for that. So, but it was an evolution for my father. And I think, again, I challenge all of you who are apolitical, maybe on the other side of the fence, take a look at ideas. Look at ideas. Look at these American dream stories. Think about them. Think about what you want for your own families and for yourself. And make a decision based on your own investigation of these things, not based on what your professor tells you, not based on one-sided view that you're getting from the media or from Hollywood, but really take a look at these ideas, because I think they have a lot to offer our community. Thank you so much for having me.
I just want to make an announcement on behalf of YAF. We want to thank Rachel Campos-Duffy for coming today. And please join us next month. We have another speaker. We have Rick Santorum coming in the house. And thank you for everybody coming out today. And Ben Shapiro.